people could the ship hold at that time?
Well, there's 100 of them down there.
100.
And then there's the crew of the ship up here, which is maybe 25 to 30 possible.
Señores, ahora vamos a entrar en Mayflower 2 para conocer cómo era ese barco que trajo a los peregrinos en el siglo XVII. Así que continuamos mostrándole a ustedes parte de este comienzo de la historia de los Estados Unidos.
Señores, todos a bordo. Bienvenidos a Mayflower 2. Esta embarcación es la reproducción a gran escala del Museo Plymouth Patuchet del barco alto que llevó a los peregrinos a Plymouth en el año 1620. Se puede decir que el Mayflower 2 es donde se hizo el viaje que inició esta gran nación americana.
Saben, yo también estuve en la naval en el USS Nimitz de aquí de los Estados Unidos de 92-96, pero no me quiero imaginar lo que era navegar en un barco como este en el siglo XVII.
El barco se considera una fiel reproducción genérica con algunos detalles actuales que podemos ver como luces eléctricas añadidas y escaleras sustituidas por una escalera en la cubierta inferior, con vigas de roble macizo, aparejos de cáñamo arquitranado y mapas coloreados a mano. Tiene 32 metros de largo por 7.6 metros de ancho. Pesa 236 toneladas de desplazamiento, 3 mástiles, mayor, trinquete, mesana, un bauprés y 6 velas.
So they're leaving England after they already wanted to be here. Because they're leaving later, they're coming across during hurricane season. They don't know that, of course, but we do, not just from the time of year it is, but the weather they described, sure, sounds like tropical storms blowing up the coast. Your grip is doable in about 35 days. The fact it takes them 66 tells you just how much bad weather that they're hitting. And so that's going to delay them out by another month. When they're out on the Cape, they get into a lot of misadventures out there. It's a small boat out here called the Shallop. That's a boat that the Pilgrims purchase and break up into pieces and have to have down here on the tween deck with them. They break it up into pieces and it's taking up a lot of space down here. They're so stretched for space down here that they start sleeping inside the pieces of it. That just distorts it and makes it even harder to put back together. The first thing they do when they get up to Provincetown is float all that ashore and try to put it back together. They're expecting that to take 4 or 5 days, and they're relying on the skill of the ship's carpenter to do it. They're convinced he's just being slow and lazy about it because it takes him 17 days to get it put back together. He says it's so badly distorted because it's been disassembled for months and from them sleeping inside the pieces of it that he just wants to burn it and start from scratch and build him a new boat. But they do finally get it back together, but that's another delay. They try to sail south to where they're supposed to be going, which is Manhattan. At this point, the Hudson River is the northernmost boundary to the Virginia Bay Colony. English want to be on English soil, far enough away from any other governing body that no one will interfere with them living their lives and practicing their faith as they believe God intends them to. So they're trying to establish an outpost on the northernmost boundary of the colony, instead of in Jamestown itself. When they try to head south, it's an area south of the Cape that's filled with sandbars and shallows. It's only navigable certain parts of the year. Fun fact, it's not November when they're trying to do it. And while they're in those waters, they get caught in a real harsh north blowing winter storm. Now they can't sail south. They kind of give up, come back up here to the Cape. That storm dumps 6 inches of snow on the Cape. They're getting desperate to settle anywhere. There's a navigator on board who's been in New England before, and he says there's a great harbor just to the north of here. We also believe they're using maps provided by John Smith. I always want to say Will Smith. John Smith, famously of Jamestown. He's approached later on in life and asked if he would have guided the pilgrims here. And he says that they approached me, but they only could afford my maps, not me. So they also were widely distributed in England. For all of those reasons, we think they are using maps of him. And Plymouth Harbor is actually marked as Plymouth Harbor on his maps.
Los pasajeros de Mayflower vivieron a bordo entre 7 y 9 meses, dependiendo de cuándo se unieron al viaje y qué tan pronto abandonaron el barco para refugiarse en tierra. Amigos del canal, por eso llama la atención de inmediato lo pequeño que parece el barco, especialmente en la cubierta intermedia, donde estaban confinados los pasajeros. ¿Cómo pudieron 102 personas, incluidas 3 madres embarazadas, haber sobrevivido todo ese tiempo en un espacio de este tamaño? Es muy sorprendente, ¿no?
That means if you're working above us on the steerage cabin, the whipstaff will move in the same direction that the ship moves. So the person above us steering the ship, if they move the whipstaff to the right, to starboard side, the ship will also follow and go to the right, to the starboard side. The other thing to see is, this is the gun deck over here. There would have been probably 2 cannons on the gun deck. This is actually the back of the ship, but your first point of contact if you get an encounter with the pirate, right, is going to be through firing the cannons through the back. Because plan A, if you ever see a pirate ship, get away. So as you're going away from the ship, though, you can fire the cannon through the back.
Nadie sabe con certeza qué pasó con el Mayflower, el barco original. El último registro del barco fue una evaluación de su valor en 1624. Después de eso, desapareció de los registros marítimos internacionales. Varios lugares de Inglaterra afirman tener una parte del barco original, pero no hay pruebas históricas que respalden esas afirmaciones.
Amigos, me dicen que este barco en verdad tiene como 18 pulgadas menos. O sea, el barco original tenía 18 pulgadas menos. Y esto lo hicieron así para mostrárselo a los turistas de una altura más grande.
Es importante agregar que el Mayflower no es completamente accesible. Las personas con discapacidad o dificultad para caminar deben saber que hay rampas que pueden ser empinadas según las subidas y bajadas de las mareas. En el barco también hay varios tramos de escalera para subir. Sin embargo, aquellos que no puedan abordar el barco pueden disfrutar de una vista de cerca de Mayflower desde el muelle que podemos ver. También pueden visitar el área de exhibición junto al muelle, hablar con miembros de la tripulación modernos y mirar fotografías del interior del barco.
Your grace will be enough when my eyes can't see. What you have prepared for me, your grace will be enough. And strength is rising as I wait patiently. Your words, they come for me. Strength is rising. Lift up your heads, you weary souls. Our God is not done yet. Our King will come with the morning light, bringing joy to the darkest of night. Carry on, all you pilgrims. Don't lose heart.
How many people could the ship hold at a time?
Well, there's 100 of them down there.
100.
And then there's a crew in the ship up here, which is maybe 25 to 30 passengers. We're not sure.
Okay.
But, crowd is for sure. Yeah.
This would definitely rock hard and storm.
Oh, yeah.
Scary.
They had some storms on the way, too, yeah.
Yeah.
But they managed to get through it. Yeah.
See the grace that he giveth and giveth and giveth again. Your word will be enough when I cannot hear. When I start to
So the reason the knots are every 42 feet, those of you that are joining us, we are talking about calculating the speed of ships. It's 1620. 42 feet is 1/120th of an English mile. All right, I told you it's fractions. And the reason that they're counting how many knots going through their fingers for 30 seconds is because 30 seconds is 1/120th of 30 minutes. So by doing that equation, they're going to figure out how many knots per 30 minutes they're going. All right, whereas today we're doing knots per hour. All right, so knots per half hour versus knots per hour. And one of the reasons they're probably doing this knots per half hour is because everything on the ship in this time is really based on the half hour. All right, we have our bell over here, which you folks probably have seen. Please don't touch it. There's a bell for you to ring before you exit if you'd like. But that bell would be rung every half hour to let everyone on board the ship know what time it is. They also, so then they would know what time it was for the end of their shift. They're going to ring it 8 times at the end of a 4-hour shift to let them know one has ended and the next 4-hour shift has begun. And also, if you need all hands on deck, you're just going to ring that thing as hard as you can.
Carry on, oh, you pilgrims. Don't lose heart, his strength will still come at the end. See the grace that he giveth and giveth and giveth again.
Bueno, señores, ya nos vamos a desembarcar de aquí de Mayflower 2. ¿Qué le pareció a ustedes el barco para navegar 2 meses por el Atlántico?
No,
ningún valiente aquí en esta familia para navegar. Así que ni a mí me hubiera gustado viajar 2 meses en un barco como este, solo temiendo a las tormentas. Pero gracias a Dios que ellos lo pudieron lograr y pudieron fundar esta gran nación que debemos proteger y debemos hacer todo lo posible por seguir unidos, así como se llaman los Estados Unidos. Unidos, no divididos, como los medios nos quieren hacer estar. Bueno, ya nos estamos desembarcando de aquí, señores. Muy interesante este viaje a Plymouth, Massachusetts. Se los recomiendo para los que les gusta la historia. Específicamente, ustedes saben que a mí no me gusta tanto. Lo que me gusta es estar en el campo, la naturaleza. Pero creí que para hacer una serie de videos de los Estados Unidos es muy importante comenzar por aquí, por Plymouth. Con la historia de los peregrinos.
At the end of your wanderings, you'll see the grace that he giveth and giveth and giveth again.
I'll be outside.
Buenos amigos, después de un largo día, es tiempo de ir a descansar y nos vamos a quedar en el Best Western Plus Cold Spring, que está en la 180 Cold Street de Plymouth, Massachusetts. Es apenas unos minutos desde el muelle donde está el Mayflower 2. Vamos a darle una muestra de cómo se ve el hotel por dentro, ya que este es uno de los lugares que vienen muchas personas al visitar el Patuxent Museum. Señores, ya estamos aquí en el hotel donde nos vamos a quedar, el Best Western Plus en Plymouth. No está mal, les voy a mostrar. Valió para 4 personas, los niños y mi esposa y yo, como 340 para tener el sofá bed también. Al entrar, tenemos suite. Dos camas queen. No se ve nada mal la habitación, pero claro, está un poco caro, pero eso debe ser también por cargo extra para 4 personas. Vamos a ver el baño. Normal. Normal. Nada impresionante, pero no está mal. Está bien para una familia. Es solo un día. Claro, $340. No es que tan barato para mi gusto, pero ya todo está caro. ¿Qué tal si tratamos esa cama? Y lo vamos a hacer en honor a un gran youtuber que ha sido inspiración para mí, uno de los mejores youtubers, Alan por el mundo. Así que en honor a Alan por el mundo. Me dolió la espalda, Alan. ¿Qué le parece, señores? Que ahora, después que yo salté a la cama, es que me acuerda a la familia. Que yo hace poco tuve una cirugía del estómago. No estoy supuesto a hacer eso. ¿Está todo bien ahí todavía? Por eso es que ustedes quizás me ven un poco más flaco, porque he estado en dieta estricta por ya 4 semanas, casi 5.